Hello viewers, welcome to J-Hub. Today we have a distinguished guest, Major Sunil Shetty. Sir, welcome.
Thank you.
A veteran and an entrepreneur, sir. That's an interesting combination. Would you tell our viewers how you started on this journey, sir?
Actually, I've coined a word for that. Mm-hmm. It is called soldierpreneur.
Okay.
Soldier who has become an entrepreneur.
Okay.
So I fused these two words and called it soldierpreneur.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So yeah, you know, veterans who have gone into entrepreneurship.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not the only one.
Mm-hmm.
There are many soldiers or veterans, you know, a better word for them, who have turned entrepreneurs. In fact, there's a group by the same WhatsApp group by the same name called what soldierpreneur group.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, where there are veterans who have taken to entrepreneurship of all ranks,
mm-hmm.
officers, jawans, everybody. And the interesting bit is, many years ago, see, I come from an armed forces background. And my father, when he came out of the Air Force after his retirement, the best he could think of was taking up a job. Okay, business was not on many people's mind, you know, because they were not equipped for it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Today, if you see, most young officers coming out or officers coming out, many of them are on entrepreneurship. They have taken to entrepreneurship.
Interesting.
They are in IT field.
Mm-hmm.
Recently, I did an interview for my TV channel with one Captain P.D. Rao, who is an infantry officer and running a cyber security company.
Okay.
I mean, it's like you can't even understand that part because he's an infantry soldier. You know, when you say infantry, is somebody who's, you know, basically specialized in ground warfare, right?
Mm-hmm.
Whereas he's running a cyber security company, you know.
Exactly.
And that way, there are many. There is an officer who runs a tourism, you know, mobile tourism company.
Caravans.
Okay, caravans. Yes,
mm-hmm.
Exactly. There are officers who are into, you know, the shoes making, you know, leather products.
Okay.
You know, so they are doing multiple jobs. No more the same old running a security company supplying some stuff. They're doing a variety of jobs, variety of businesses. So they're soldierpreneurs.
Thank you, Major. You preempted me. I exactly wanted to ask this question because most of these soldierpreneurs that you mentioned, are they choosing fields which are related to somehow their service, or is it the field is wide open so they can choose anything under the sun?
See, so. One good thing is as a soldier, right? You learn a lot of things by default. You know, you kind of inherit it, like planning. You know, your strong will to go through the journey of, you know, a pressure situation. You know, entrepreneurship is full of pressure.
Yes, sir. Handling pressure is very important.
Very important. So they go, they are equipped mentally. They are equipped to do that. You know, they have the mindset to do that. They are all very methodical in their job. How the work is done, right? So they can think through the process. So they are using all that they have learned during their army career or Air Force Army Armed Forces career. They come out and they're either picking up a business which is relevant to their passion or experience,
mm-hmm.
okay, or something that they hit upon, you know, they just chanced upon something.
Mm-hmm.
So they're going into different, so they are not sticking to, because army does not provide you all the exposure, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they're doing things which probably is nowhere relevant to the kind of job they did in the armed forces. But yes, they get into multiple fields, multiple streams.
That's very interesting. Before we delve deeper into the business aspects, can you give a brief background about your personal life? Where did you start? Were you always a Hyderabadi? Or?
Oh, well, that's a complex question to answer because I was born in Haryana because
mm-hmm.
my dad was posted there in
okay.
Ambala.
Mm-hmm.
And I originally come by descent. I come from Mangalore. I'm a Bunt, I'm a Shetty, so
mm-hmm.
I come from there.
Mm-hmm.
But then my dad, after his retirement from the Air Force in 1975,
mm-hmm.
he settled in Hyderabad.
Okay.
So I was 5 years old when he settled down here. And since then, you know, I was here all along. So I did my schooling, basic schooling here. I did my intermediate, graduation, post-graduation, everything in Hyderabad. So I'm a Hyderabadi more than anything else, you know.
Mm-hmm. Any fond memories of Osmania University?
Oh, great. Yes, I remember, you know, when we had to, I mean, there are many, you know, this place is great, right?
Yes,
so,
yes.
I remember, you know, first time going into the, to sell our department newspaper to the library.
Mm-hmm.
And in the library, a lot of people ask me, I didn't know that, you know, our university publishes newspaper. Mm-hmm. I said, now you know. Mm-hmm. So buy this. Mm-hmm. Those days that you had, I think the cost was 1 rupee per paper.
Okay.
I remember I sold about 1,000 papers.
Wow. That must have been a departmental record, I think.
Oh, yes, I remember. I don't know if the professor remember or not, but everybody said this guy is like, he went and sold 1,000 papers, you know.
I'm surprised no business school immediately snatched you up.
No, those days, all these things were not there.
Talent sports were not so active.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then how did you hit upon the idea that you wanted to serve in the armed forces? Is it a family tradition?
I would say it's more like a tradition.
Mm-hmm.
My father was in the Air Force. Mm-hmm. My maternal grandfather was in the Army.
Mm-hmm.
One of my maternal uncles served in the Army during the 62 war
mm-hmm.
for a brief period. And, so naturally when you're growing up in that environment, hearing all these war stories, because my father was in the 70th war. Thereafter, my father was in during 65 war,
mm-hmm.
my grandfather was there 62 war. So you hear, you know, when you're growing up as a defense kid, you're learning, you're hearing all these stories. So
it was
very natural get the affinity towards armed forces.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, I did my basic school from Air Force School,
okay.
Begumpet.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, all around me, there were, you know, airmen or pilots were, you know, you could, because the school was situated inside Air Force Station.
Mm-hmm.
So you saw that every day. And all my classmates were people whose parents were serving in the Air Force or Army.
Army
right?
brats.
So it was very natural that you wanted to go to that.
Okay.
That's how, you know, the affinity towards armed forces was always there.
Mm-hmm.
That led me to take to NCC during my college days,
okay.
graduation.
Mm-hmm.
And that was 3 years of C certificate. And
mm-hmm.
then
mm-hmm.
naturally when you finish that, you know, you want to go for the
yes.
armed forces.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, that's the journey. It was a natural progression towards armed forces, I would say.
Okay. So what were some of the interesting postings you had, sir? Did you ever serve in Kashmir?
No, I did not get a chance to serve in Kashmir because I was there only for about 6 years in the army.
Mm-hmm.
But my first posting was in Manipur, northeast,
oh, okay.
on the Burma border.
Mm-hmm.
That is where I won the gallantry award also. And thereafter, my next posting was with the unit. Obviously, in army, especially in infantry, you basically get posted initial, first initial years are always with the unit, right?
Mm-hmm.
So my first, my unit was deployed in northeast. So that immediately after commissioning, I went there. Then I came to, along with the unit, my unit got posted.
And your unit was? 12
Dogras. So then it got posted, you know, it got moved to Faizabad
mm-hmm.
in UP. Near Ayodhya, so we were there for some time.
Mm-hmm.
Thereafter, my unit moved to Punch in
mm-hmm.
JNK.
Mm-hmm.
But by the time I had got injured
uh-huh.
During a training
okay.
period, and I was, you know, I had to be moved to another unit. So
mm-hmm.
I moved to 9, which was in Punjab,
mm-hmm.
and this was at the peak of Kargil War.
Mm-hmm.
So during Kargil, you know, I was deployed on the international border along the India-Pakistan border
mm-hmm.
in Punjab. So
mm-hmm.
that was my posting. But the best time I had was Manipur,
mm-hmm.
you know, got to see Northeast from such a close quarter.
Yes, yes.
We also took part in an operation which had to go into the Burma, into Myanmar.
Mm-hmm.
And I did a lot of operations there as a young officer.
Mm-hmm.
And one of them which led to a
mm-hmm.
Big, you know, catch in 1995,
okay.
Which got me a gallantry award also.
Mm-hmm. That's great news. Oh. can you divulge any of the details or is it confidential?
Yeah, no, there's no confidential. I mean, so I was still in, I think, in the first year of my service.
Mm-hmm.
And so as a second lieutenant, those days we still had the rank second lieutenant, which is no more there, now
mm-hmm.
abolished. So we did this operation inside into a jungle where there was an int report that, you know, some NSC and Moiwa group activity was there. So we laid in stealth for about, you know, overnight and next day morning we caught, we intercepted actually
okay.
a gypsy and while searching we realized that they were carrying some weapons in the and it led to a small fire, crossfire between us and we caught these people. Luckily, the only thing for me, good takeaway was none of my jawans got killed. The boys, you know, that was amazing. Because it's not worth it doing anything if you know, if you lose people, you know. But then, you know, but yes, if an operation like Kargil demands it, so be it, you know. When we join armed forces, we know, you know, the risk we are carrying with it. But that particular operation, the good part was that, you know, it did not, there was no casualty on our part. But we ended up capturing somebody called Captain Samson Jojo. Those days he was known as the North Tongkul region head.
Okay.
And that was the biggest catch
big fish,
from
yes,
North.
Yes,
it was a big fish.
Uh-huh.
And that led to a gallantry award for me. And yeah, that was the operation.
Oh, great to know. Oh, at that time, was it Isaac Moiwa already, or is it only Moiwa Group?
No, Moiwa Group was there, Isaac Group was there.
At that time, they were not
Isaac
together.
Isaac Moiwa is a one group. The other was a Kaplan Group, which is K. NSCNK and NSCNIM.
Yes. Yes. K operates from Burma, deep inside Burma.
Burma, yes.
Yes. Okay, that's great to know. Let's come back to your business ventures. So after... I think after you've studied business journalism in Osmania, you picked it up afterwards once again. What was the motivation?
So see, I was, as I said, the only two professions that gives me that rush I need. You know, one is the army, the other is journalism.
Okay.
Okay. So running with a camera is as to me gives me the same rush as running with a rifle
or a weapon. Shoot with a gun or shoot with a camera.
Camera, the same thing, right?
Okay.
So, so I always had a passion for photography and camera, but my generation did not have access to smartphones, nor one could afford a camera of basic camera those days, you know. So, but then, so that actually got me into journalism.
Okay.
Okay. When I got into journalism, I realized it was not just photography. There are so many other things, aspects to, you know, journalism. And I started seeing the very small little things like the two, you know, the two sides of a story, you know, the five W's and H, you know. Now, how would that make sense? It makes sense because whatever I learned here, when I went to armed forces, okay, because I couldn't finish my exam. So I did everything else, project report, everything I did, but I could not complete the written exam because my joining orders for the army had come. So I went and joined army, and now I knew that I wanted to complete it at any cost. So what I realized was the critical thought process that journalism built, I carried forward that into armed forces also. And the passion continued in the sense that I even volunteered to write one of the books, regimental history books, which were not which had not been updated for a long time.
Okay.
I think the last, the first edition was the I got commissioned to Dogra Regiment, and the Dogra regimental history book was, I think, last published was somewhere in 80s. Okay, so as a second lieutenant, when I went to the center, our regimental center, I couldn't get much news or information about my own battalion. It was just one page, and I was like, why is this? So, as luck would have it, when my unit came back to regimental center, which is our center, General Bedi was visiting, who was our colonel of the regiment, was visiting the unit. And in one of the talks, I offered to write the edition of the book, and he was very happy. He said, good. He said, what, so how would you write? I said, sir, I used to be a journalism student, so I know how to do it. And he said, go ahead. And I was instrument in bringing out the second edition of the regimental history, and you know, that was a passion. I continued. So the whole idea of that, when you go through journalism, you know, it builds that critical mindset, you know, and more importantly, to see both sides of the story. I think as a journalist, if you do, if you forget that basic principle, and I apply that in my day-to-day life. For example, if one of my employees comes and talks to me about something, my natural instinct is, what is the other side of the story?
Yes.
He might be telling me something, but what's the other side of the story? Not that you mistrust it, but the critical thought process.
Yes.
So I think that kept me to journalism. So even when I was a when I was in the army, I came back and finished, I wrote my exam and finished it. But then that helped me, because when I left, finally when I decided to, you know, come out of the army, I went back to a journalism.
So it was a sabbatical before you finished the course. In those days, sabbatical was not even a fashionable term.
Yes, that's wonderful.
And also now I think even a author of a history book can be added to your resume, I would say. And by the way, is the book available for civilians, or is it only an institutional library kind of a thing?
It's institutional, but definitely, you know, that book is there, because I wrote it in, so what I did was I compiled all the history of the other regiments after the first edition, and then I put it up together and gave it to the regimental center. They for some reason decided to translate that to Hindi and print it, but then they gave me due credit for it by putting my name into it, but that's fine. Idea was not the name, more important was that I wanted a second edition which had updated history of the regimental center.
Okay. I would love to get my hands on that book.
Sure. I'm sure I have
what's
a copy of that.
What's the war cry of Dogra Regiment, sir? Is it Badri Visha?
No, it is Jaijwala.
Okay. Coming back to journalism, when did you decide that you wanted to go abroad and you know, pursue your higher studies in journalism?
So when I came out, I was very clear that I wanted to go to journalism.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So this is what I did. Mm-hmm. I decided that I will join the MCA course. Those days it was MCA, mm-hmm. MCJ. So I said I have to go back and join MCJ. So I, again, this is another thing. I carried all my notes from mm-hmm. the BCJ,
okay.
all the 6 years of my army career.
Oh.
I had them with them, mm-hmm. with me, right? So whenever I would get time, I would just go back and refer to it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So when I decided to leave army and I put in my papers to quit,
mm-hmm.
So I had about a month. So, 1 month before that, I started studying.
Mm-hmm.
Because I knew I had to come back
mm-hmm.
and I'll appear for the exams and then
yes.
get into MCJ.
Mm-hmm.
That was the idea.
Mm-hmm.
I came in, I did that. Okay. And that's the time when I got internship into journalism here.
Mm-hmm.
I got an internship at Deccan Chronicle.
Okay.
And then I started thinking, there was a, those days, in the year 2001 mm-hmm. Period,
mm-hmm.
Going to London or America and doing a master's course, any course for that matter,
mm-hmm.
was a great difficult,
mm-hmm.
real
mm-hmm.
difficult because student loans were not popular.
Okay.
Okay, going to these places, getting a visa itself was a challenge.
Mm-hmm.
I remember for the UK visa, I stood 3 days in Chennai because the consulates were not in all cities.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Exactly.
So, UK consulate was only in Chennai for
mm-hmm.
South India.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So, I stood outside the council in big line queue
mm-hmm.
for 3 days.
Mm-hmm.
Still couldn't get inside.
Oh.
Okay. Oh, that is standing night and day.
Right.
Me and my wife were taking turns and standing there.
Okay.
Still, we couldn't get anywhere close
mm-hmm.
to it. Those were the days.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, you know what? So there was one of the 5-star hotels. There was a fair, student
mm-hmm.
fair.
Mm-hmm.
So somehow, you know, my wife arranged it. I could go get in
mm-hmm.
and meet one of these friends. I said, these courses are different. They're structured
mm-hmm.
differently.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, I might well do it from there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
mm-hmm.
and that led me to go and do journalism. You know, do a course from there.
Which university did you choose?
City University,
City
London.
University, London.
Yeah.
Wow. That must have been a very interesting experience.
Definitely,
mm-hmm.
Especially the hands-on experience that you get.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you got the courses are structured like that,
mm-hmm.
where there are more hands-on.
Mm-hmm.
And I still remember the final exam.
Mm-hmm.
One of the papers was not a book. And you know, coming as an Indian student, you want to have books, you know, you can read and important questions. There it was no books.
Mm.
The library was full, you had to pick up the book
mm-hmm.
from the subject, they would give you references and you would pick
okay.
up from there.
Mm-hmm.
And I distinctly remember this, one of the papers that we had to write was basically from the that day's newspaper.
Okay.
And news story would be marked from there and then you have to write the.
Oh,
so you know,
very interesting.
How would you even prepare for something like that?
Yes,
you know, so I think the teaching methodology is completely different,
mm-hmm.
and so much of importance to practical work
mm-hmm.
vis-a-vis you know, just the classroom classes,
mm-hmm.
Lectures, and I still remember there was also a session where one of the professors did. So a voice trainer
mm-hmm.
Would do some classes with you on pronunciations.
Mm-hmm.
Because
okay.
if you're a radio television journalist,
mm-hmm.
you need to be very,
mm-hmm.
you know, your vocabulary has to be clear, right?
Okay.
So you see how they had gone into that kind of depth,
okay.
you know. So because mm-hmm. students were different places,
and
right?
You
so
could English. Not get away saying that no, I'll be behind the camera. No.
No, you
everybody
could.
Has
everybody
to
has to do it. It didn't matter
good.
Whether you were behind the camera or in front of the camera.
Mm-hmm.
You know, in our case, because it was radio
mm-hmm.
journalism course,
mm-hmm.
We couldn't say I'm going to be, you know, not reading
yeah.
the news.
Yeah.
But you had to do it, you know, whatever it was.
Excellent, excellent. I think other than the location and setting, even the student body must have been international.
We were 84, about 84 students,
mm-hmm.
and pretty much from, you know, across the globe.
Okay.
There were students from China,
mm-hmm.
America, the other end, Australia, New Zealand.
Mm-hmm.
They were from, some from the Middle East,
mm-hmm.
they were from Africa. They were from Europe, they were from Asia.
Okay.
You know, I think there were only 3 Indian students, if I remember distinctly,
mm-hmm.
2 from Delhi and 1 from Hyderabad.
Okay.
So pretty much representing
mm-hmm.
South India was me. So,
okay.
yeah. So that was also another big advantage
mm-hmm.
that you, and most of them, by the way, unlike in our system of education,
mm-hmm.
we tend to do degree after degree.
Yes.
We finish school,
mm-hmm.
intermediate,
mm-hmm.
we do degree
yes.
and then we get into post-graduation.
Mm-hmm.
There, they kind of take a sabbatical,
mm-hmm.
right? They go into doing a year or 2 years of experience.
Mm-hmm.
And I realized that one of the disadvantages I had
mm-hmm.
while doing this course was, I was one of those least experienced
mm-hmm.
Students from journalism.
Mm-hmm.
There were students who were on television anchors. Mm-hmm. There were students who had worked as journalists. Mm-hmm. There were students who had done few years of, 3, 4, 5 years of experience.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously their production quality was far superior than, mine. And it took me some time. There the kick in army thing kicked in.
Uh-huh.
That, when you don't know something, you overwork.
Uh-huh.
And, reach that point.
Exactly.
So by the time of the end of the year, I kind of reached somewhere close to it.
Mm-hmm.
But then the initial start was difficult.
Yes.
Because, you were nowhere close to it.
Mm-hmm.
Like there was people who had come, because this was a master's in international journalism in radio.
Mm-hmm.
They were radio journalists.
Mm-hmm.
So they already knew basics of it, right? For us, it was right from the scratch,
mm-hmm.
learning from the scratch. Mm-hmm. So that was the challenge of the differences of doing these kind of courses there and here.
Mm. But as an army man, I'm sure you have had your life experiences much more than the average person, some of them involving risk and physical danger. So probably those things also had you in good stead. Tell us, Major, what kind of internship offers did you consider while you were in the university?
Okay, so this is another very interesting thing which I want to, which I want every Indian student kind of, takes it very seriously.
Mm-hmm.
Somehow we don't pay much attention to internships,
mm-hmm.
Both as a student, as parents also,
mm-hmm.
And also our education system.
Yes.
And somehow, unfortunately, we want to equate every internship with money,
mm-hmm.
It pays you.
Yeah.
So, whereas there, what I saw, there was a strong culture of doing internships,
mm-hmm.
Irrespective of whether you are paid or not paid, okay? Some of them would pay you, which would meet just the traveling cost of yours,
mm-hmm.
right? But many of them were doing it for gaining some experience under your belt.
Mm-hmm.
So, I remember distinctly, I worked as an intern for a radio channel called Sunrise Radio,
mm-hmm.
okay? And the beauty of it was, I would travel all the way from London to outskirts, South Hall, place called South Hall, and work from there. I remember the radio editor was David Landau,
mm-hmm.
And I got to write some, I never got to do a, read a news, but definitely I got a lot of opportunity to write scripts around the news, right? And that helped me, okay? But eventually when I went to Afghanistan,
mm-hmm.
Sunrise Radio ended up hiring me as their freelancer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that was, that's how it gets paid off.
Mm-hmm.
You work, mm-hmm. you may not get paid then,
mm-hmm.
but eventually when you go, they had their own intern in Afghanistan from where they could get stories.
Yes,
so I ended up filing stories for them for almost a year,
mm-hmm.
For the radio. So so I did that internship. Then there was another project I had known, remember the name very distinctly now. One of the production houses wanted to do a story along the line of control,
mm-hmm.
okay, covering only the flora and fauna around on both sides of the line of control.
Mm-hmm.
So when I applied for it, mm-hmm. I got it primarily because I was an army guy.
Mm-hmm.
They said, oh, this guy would be perfect if I were to actually go.
Mm-hmm.
So their idea was to travel down along the LOC and capture both sides of the LOC, the flora and fauna.
Mm-hmm.
And as an army guy, it was great, for them, somebody who would understand the terrain or at least be part of
side,
it, right?
At least on one side of the border, things should be easy for you.
Easy for them. So there I worked with them on developing. Finally, that project never took off,
mm-hmm.
For obvious reasons.
Mm-hmm.
But then, that was another internship which I learned a lot on to how to plan a project before you actually get into it.
Mm-hmm.
You see, I may not have done it, but the project didn't take off.
Mm-hmm.
But personally, I gained from the planning process of it.
Okay.
And there were other production houses where I never got into it.
Mm-hmm.
But the very fact that I was standing, there were another 20 people standing with me,
mm-hmm.
told me that everybody wanted an internship.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the culture which is there in this, this part of the world, that part of the world, where students take internship very seriously,
mm-hmm.
And they're always looking for an opportunity to get into internship.
So in a way, you are pitching an idea and fighting for funds, actually.
Correct. See, in London, when I was there, I did another internship with an NGO.
Mm-hmm.
It was into, they were children NGO.
Mm-hmm.
And there I worked as business development.
Okay.
Now, what I learned with them, nothing to do with journalism,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
I just took it up.
Mm-hmm.
So, offer was there, I was not finding anything else, I took it up.
Okay.
What it taught me was how to plan for your business, the
mm-hmm.
fundraising.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You see, all these things, we don't understand how it affects. But when you take up these small internships,
mm-hmm.
and they add up into your, into your experience,
mm-hmm.
they're there somewhere, back of your mind.
Yes, yes.
When the time comes, you are able to connect the dots.
Yes, yes,
just to share with you, there is ex-Z channel vice president, mm-hmm. Mukund Kare.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, right now I think he's with Dish TV.
Mm-hmm.
So he spent, he was in Afghanistan,
mm-hmm.
where when Z wanted to launch a channel for Afghanistan.
Okay.
So I was lucky to be with him for a while,
mm-hmm.
and I spent a very small time with him while he was trying to create a budget for,
mm-hmm.
For a television channel.
Mm-hmm.
Just that 2 days of work with him,
mm-hmm.
and seeing him actually work on how to work a budget for a channel gave me so much of understanding. So I've not done an MBA,
mm-hmm.
but I learned how to do the numbers,
mm-hmm.
how to plan for 3 years instead okay. of planning for just 1 month or 6 months,
mm-hmm.
or 1 year. You know, I consider that as an internship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sitting with him, working with a person whose
mm-hmm.
job is to do that,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
So all these experiences, a little bit of experience here and there,
mm-hmm.
they all add up.
Wow.
But mm-hmm. as long as you see that way,
mm-hmm.
if you only think, oh, I'm wasting my time here. See, if you think of this, the production house LOC project never went anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So technically, I did not gain anything out of it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but I gained knowledge.
Mm-hmm.
ZTV never came, the Afghan channel never took off,
mm-hmm.
but I learned how to do the numbers,
mm-hmm.
right? So whatever little bit of experience I got, it helped me when the time came.
Okay.
Today, whatever I learned with my exposure with those 2 days of exposure sitting with Mr. Mukund Kare,
mm-hmm.
today I use all of that whenever I'm building. That is the base.
Okay.
I work around it,
mm-hmm.
because
mm-hmm.
that's what I learned.
So you got a free MBA in the...
I won't say MBA, but at least I understood how to do business numbers, you know, when you're working on numbers. Yeah.
Oh, okay. You mentioned Afghanistan a couple of times. So how did that happen?
Interesting story. So, you know, as part of your master's program, we were supposed to submit a thesis and also a documentary, radio documentary.
Mm-hmm.
So, as a, you know, so your idea is to pick up a current subject,
mm-hmm.
Or topic, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I was surfing through the net and I found there was this small article which said, you know, the NATO forces, international forces are trying to rebuild Afghan army.
Mm-hmm.
And as an army person, I was said that was quite a challenge, mm-hmm. you know, build a 70,000 strong army.
Mm-hmm.
It requires a lot of effort. I said, what could be the challenges? So I proposed this as a subject,
mm-hmm.
you know, the challenges of rebuilding Afghan army,
mm-hmm.
and as luck would have it, that got picked up.
Mm-hmm.
But the icing on the cake was when I came to know about a scholarship called Neon's Brewery,
mm-hmm.
and I applied for it,
mm-hmm.
to produce this radio documentary.
Mm-hmm.
And as luck would have it, I got 50% of the brochure, which was completely against their regular mm-hmm. process that they do every year.
Unusual,
yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason I got it was because this was a place where I had said I would go to Afghanistan and then produce the program.
Oh.
And I got $600, mm-hmm. £600,
mm-hmm.
and I used £400 of it to buy a ticket,
mm-hmm.
from London to
mm-hmm.
Afghanistan, Kabul.
Mm-hmm.
And $100 I paid for, I used it for paying to my translator.
Mm-hmm.
And $100 was what I could, £100 which was I could use for my expenses.
Mm-hmm.
I lived in a gurdwara there,
mm-hmm.
and I produced a program.
Mm-hmm.
So while doing that, towards the last day of the interviews that I was doing, various interviews or talking to various people there, I ran into John West. He was the country director of Internews.
Mm-hmm.
Internews is a news NGO,
mm-hmm.
that is basically into running various news projects.
Okay.
At that time, they had an opening for a media monitoring project,
mm-hmm.
which was to monitor all the
mm-hmm.
media in Afghanistan.
Mm-hmm.
And they were looking for somebody to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And he offered that thing.
Mm-hmm.
He said, would you like to do it? And as an Indian, you know, the student, mm-hmm. I was thinking, I have this loan on my head,
mm-hmm.
Which I had taken from mm-hmm. Malawad Bank. Mm-hmm. And I said, I have to repay back.
Okay.
So I asked him, how much would you pay me?
Mm-hmm.
And he said £3,000, the 3,000
wow.
euros those days.
Mm-hmm.
I said great. So somebody asked me when I went back to London, because I still had to write my exam,
mm-hmm.
you know. So I went, presented thesis and all, and mm-hmm. they said, why would you leave London and go to Afghanistan?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I said, listen, two things.
Mm-hmm.
First, I didn't come to London to settle down here.
Yeah.
Okay, mm-hmm. very clear.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, I'm getting to do real journalism there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and I'm getting paid for it. What more do I want? You know, the day I finished my exam, I just picked the next flight, reached Kabul. I didn't know that I would live there for next 12 years. But between 2001 to 2005,
mm-hmm.
I was working as a journalist and also working on various media projects.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I worked for some of the agencies like Associated Press and mm-hmm. Kuwait News Agency.
Mm-hmm.
You know, did some work, small work for UNI.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and Sunrise Radio London.
Okay.
So I got multiple exposure and experience all mm-hmm. as a freelancer.
Mm-hmm.
Then I did two concerts in Afghanistan. One was with mm-hmm. Sonu Nigam and one was with Jagjit Singh.
Okay, you were
so
also.
So by the time I had already decided to move on to being an entrepreneur.
So I formed
a company there
mm-hmm.
and that led to, we'll leave it for another day, but that led to a disaster
mm-hmm.
and I had to close down that company and then mm-hmm. get into another world altogether.
Wow, that's interesting. In army parlance, was London a family station for you or
no?
Was it,
no. I couldn't okay. afford it.
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
and I was just newly married.
Okay.
So my wife was also studying.
Mm-hmm.
She's a heart surgeon.
Mm-hmm.
So those days she was still doing her master's.
Uh-huh.
So she stayed put here okay. and continuing her studies.
And if and London was not, Afghanistan is much more difficult, I would say.
Oh yes, it was. So yes, the mm-hmm. first almost 10 years of our marriage, we kind of pretty much stayed
mm-hmm.
away from each other in terms of, okay. Mm-hmm. You know, stay-wise, yeah.
Difficult, I mean, I appreciate the family commitment, I would
yes,
say.
Yes.
Did you pick up any Pashto, Dari or other languages
yes,
in Afghanistan?
Yes. In Afghanistan, I learned the street language of Farsi,
mm-hmm.
you know, the Dari as they call it, right?
Yeah.
I picked up
mm-hmm.
the street language
mm-hmm.
and primarily learned from the taxi wallahs and,
mm-hmm.
and eventually
mm-hmm.
when I actually started doing entrepreneurship
okay.
from my own staff,
mm-hmm.
you know, I learned it
okay.
and I was pretty good with that,
okay.
you know, I could
do that.
And the motivation to learn Farsi was my own country director.
Mm.
The first one who offered me, John West,
mm-hmm.
who offered me, he used to
inter-news.
Speak. Yeah, mm-hmm. inter-news. He used to speak
fluent Farsi
and he had actually learned it, you know,
mm-hmm.
properly.
Formally.
You know, formal.
Okay, okay.
So his grammar was great. So I was
uh-huh,
like, I have to learn it like him,
uh-huh.
which I never got an opportunity. But
okay.
then I picked up this, you know,
yeah, street language. Yeah, yeah.
That is good enough for me
good,
to
good,
manage
good,
my work,
good,
you know, manage my way.
Mm-hmm. And some of the Afghans do speak Hindi, Urdu or something like that,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, they speak mm-hmm. a blend of Urdu mm-hmm. and Hindi.
What's the primary business language there? Is it English or is it some other?
Business language, you can't say like
mm-hmm.
India, but I would say pretty much the local language.
Local language.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Farsi and Dari.
Okay.
Yeah, Farsi and Pashto.
Yeah, okay. And you got along fine because of your Indian background or is it like?
No.
I do understand that Afghan people have very warm feelings towards Indians.
See, I always say this. Whenever people ask me about my experience in Afghanistan,
mm-hmm.
I say, see, when as Indians, okay, the NRIs, when you go to West,
mm-hmm.
they respect you for your degree,
mm-hmm.
either you're an engineer or you're a doctor,
mm-hmm.
They respect you for your talent
mm-hmm.
and skills,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Afghanistan is a unique place.
Mm-hmm.
They love you
mm-hmm.
for being Indian. That's
yes,
about it.
Yes.
They don't expect anything.
Mm-hmm.
You're Indian, that's about it.
Mm-hmm.
They just love you for
mm-hmm.
that.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I felt more warm
mm-hmm.
in Afghanistan
mm-hmm.
than in London and US.
Yes.
I have traveled to quite a few countries,
mm-hmm.
but the warmth which the Afghans kind of receive you,
mm-hmm.
I've not seen it elsewhere.
Okay. Were there any security situations? Were there any near misses or something like that? In Afghanistan,
I was a conflict reporter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, as a conflict reporter, I was, you know, doing all this.
Mm-hmm.
I was working as freelancers, right?
Mm-hmm.
There was one incident.
Mm-hmm.
I don't recall the year. I think it was 2004 or 2005,
mm-hmm.
when one of the U.S. Troops had killed a local boy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because he was following the convoy,
mm-hmm.
and they shot him,
mm-hmm.
and that led to a huge demonstration in Kabul,
mm-hmm.
and as a freelancer,
mm-hmm.
I was, you know, I took my camera,
mm-hmm.
got into the thing.
Mm-hmm.
I was trying to get footage as much as
mm-hmm.
possible.
Mm-hmm.
And my driver was there, translator driver was there. It so happened that somewhere along this, you know, I got trapped in a lane, which I had a dead end. And there were this bunch of kids, you know,
mm-hmm.
rushing towards
mm-hmm.
Me. And I thought that way, because, you know, when it's a mob,
mm.
they don't see what and who,
yeah.
you know, mob doesn't bother
mm.
who you are.
Mm.
And I thought this is going to be difficult to come out of
yeah.
it because you're in a dead lane,
mm-hmm.
you're in a lane which is a dead end, your back is to the dead end,
mm-hmm.
you can't go the other side.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, from somewhere,
mm-hmm.
I remember a door opening
mm-hmm.
to my side and pulling me in.
Oh.
And that was, you know, a person somewhere there. Mm-hmm. He pulled me in, mm-hmm. locked the door,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, thereafter we went on the rooftop and we stood there.
Okay.
But still there also I was trying to recruit whatever I could from the, you know, mm-hmm. from that distance.
Okay.
So, yeah, that was the closest I came to.
Mm-hmm.
But the bigger challenge was when we were also, I had one in one of my businesses, projects I was working on.
Mm-hmm.
It was on Iran-Afghanistan border,
mm-hmm.
a place
mm-hmm.
called Adraskan.
Mm-hmm.
two of my boys got kidnapped by Taliban.
Oh.
And that day I was supposed to go,
mm-hmm.
and I didn't go in the last minute. And I was replaced by somebody else to go in it.
Hopefully they got out of that jam?
Yes.
Oh,
they were one of the Indians to come back alive from there.
Mm-hmm.
So they got kidnapped. So that these were two key important events,
mm-hmm.
you know, which was very close.
Mm-hmm.
And the biggest challenge was when I was negotiating the release for 28 days with mm-hmm. the Taliban,
mm-hmm.
you know, who the kidnappers basically.
Okay.
And the relief was when I brought these boys
mm-hmm.
back and gave them back to their families.
Mm-hmm.
That was the... Mm-hmm. moment I thought all that 28 days of, you know, hard work, you know, and the pressure situation you're going through, it was worth every minute of it, you know, giving them back a life back. In fact, one of them still works for me in Iraq.
Major, you were, as an army man, you were probably addicted to some action and probably you could be called an action junkie and you probably enjoyed your stay in Afghanistan. But do regular journalists, when they get involved in conflict reporting, what kind of risks and what kind of rewards do they face?
See, conflict reporting is a specialized field, right? You need to have some understanding of the conflict that's, you know, that's going on. So, as journalists, you would definitely be following, you know, conflicts across the world. And if you go into a specific place, for example, today, if you were to go to Syria, you know, you want to understand not just what the conflict is, what is the background to it, you know? And more importantly, you know, there'll be, as journalists, we are supposed to know all sides of the stories, right?
Yeah.
As many sides. So when you go onto the ground, you would hear stories which probably you would not hear in regular, if you're reading a newspaper,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
Because newspaper or television will be talking about what's happening right now,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
By X forces attacked mm-hmm. X, Y forces,
not the
so many
picture.
Killed, right? But what is the bigger picture? What
mm-hmm.
what's deep inside it?
Yes.
Like, I mean, when I went to Afghanistan,
mm-hmm.
I knew what the conflict was all about.
Okay.
But when I went in, I heard multiple stories of, you know, what were dynamics playing there,
mm-hmm.
which eventually came out about 8-9 years later,
mm-hmm.
right? So, like the Pakistan role itself in it,
mm-hmm.
or the American roles in itself.
Mm-hmm.
If you, I'm sure if you scan newspaper between 2001 and 2005, 6, 7, probably nobody was even talking in whispers about, you know, American role, Pakistan role and
mm-hmm.
all, which now has become, now it's, you know,
in the open.
Open. So that kind of dynamics, if you have to understand, you have to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And more importantly, listen to the common man out there,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Like if you go to Syria today,
mm-hmm.
as a conflict reporter, you would understand a lot by talking to people,
mm-hmm.
understanding, talking to the refugees. So conflict reporting is a vast field, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if conflict reporting is going to ever finish because
mm-hmm.
world
yeah.
over something is
yeah,
happening
yeah,
all the
yeah.
time, right? And so is there a way to prepare to be, you know, typically, as a student of journalism,
mm-hmm.
is there a way to prepare for it? I would say the limited way of preparing is to at least to understand and read all that you can on that conflict,
mm-hmm.
whatever wherever it's going on.
Mm-hmm.
And the other
but
way,
still go with an open mind.
Go with an open mind.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the ways of getting into any of these conflict zones or war torn areas or interest assignment is if you can get piggyback on an NGO.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, because
mm-hmm.
what it does. Usually, most of the NGOs need somebody to write their press releases,
mm-hmm.
right? Big NGOs especially, right? Though it may not be yours, your piece that you write would be released,
mm-hmm.
but somebody has to write on the ground what's happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, if you were to piggyback onto an NGO
mm-hmm.
and go there, it gets you into the system.
Mm-hmm.
Once you are there,
mm-hmm.
now you can explore.
Mm-hmm.
Usually what happens is, working with any of the NGOs, whether it is UN or other,
mm-hmm.
the projects are for 6 months, 1 year.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a good enough time for you to create great links around it. And today, any big channel, okay,
mm-hmm.
if you can directly contact them and say, I am right now in Syria, for example, right?
Okay.
If I write to them,
mm-hmm.
I'm in Syria, I'm a journalist, with so much of experience, or I was a student of journalism,
mm-hmm.
you know, I'll be happy to contribute as a freelancer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm sure they will pick it up.
Yes.
Right? Who doesn't want
yeah.
their own feed coming mm-hmm. in and own reporter giving
yeah.
them stories?
Yeah.
So it's doable.
Mm-hmm.
That's all.
Mm-hmm.
But yes, one of the biggest challenge of being in a conflict area is the insurance is very expensive.
Mm-hmm.
Like in India, no insurance company I know of covers, gives you a life insurance to go to conflict zones.
Mm-hmm.
And there are European insurance companies, but they're expensive.
Mm-hmm.
So that kind of risk you have to take. So like
mm-hmm.
in Afghanistan, when I was there, for the first 5-6 years, there was no insurance.
Mm-hmm.
I just, you know, Bhagwan bharose chalte rahe, you know, but you have to prepare to take those risks. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very, very varied and interesting life that you've led, and I'm sure you have more ventures, and but we will talk about them in due course of time. Soldier, journalist, entrepreneur, and also a writer of a history book. You are a very interesting man, Major. Very nice talking to you.
Thank you. Thanks for inviting
me. Thank you very
much.